Star Trek The Original Series, Season 2, Episode 14, Wolf in the Fold. This is kind of a crazy episode. It's sort of a slasher episode of Star Trek, which is interesting because with the exception of movies like Psycho and Peeping Tom, it predates the slasher craze by about a decade. It also has a lot of other horror movie tropes as well. Possession, seances, all kinds of spooky shit. It should be a pretty fun episode, but I don't actually like it all that much. I think it's, at best, it's pretty average. Which is good for me, because hopefully it will at least give me a few things to poke fun at. And I think we should just get right into it. The episode opens up on a planet called Argalius II. Kirk, McCoy, and Scotty are in some kind of nightclub. They're watching a belly dancer. This planet seems like sort of a Ryza prototype in a weird way. It's described as completely hedonistic. The people basically just like to party and enjoy themselves. The dancer finishes her performance and Scotty starts pounding on the table. Kirk says you're supposed to applaud by hitting a button on the table that causes a lamp to blink. So it's kind of like a silent applause, but Scotty prefers to make a lot of noise. He's basically like the wolf from those old Tex Avery cartoons. Maybe he's the wolf in the fold, eh? I guess we'll see. And Scotty gets to talking with the belly dancer, and he takes her for a walk. And then we find out that Scotty is recovering from a severe concussion, which was apparently caused by a woman.
Don't forget, the explosion that threw Scotty against the bulkhead was caused by a woman.
Physically, he's all right. Am I right in assuming that?
Oh, yes, yes. And matter of fact, considerable psychological damage could have been caused. For example, his total resentment toward women.
He seems to be overcoming his resentment.
So, this is obviously one of those unfortunate episodes of the original series that feels dated, to say the least. They don't go into too much detail, but apparently, Scotty is recovering from an injury which was caused by a woman. And this has developed a, quote, total resentment towards women. I mean, what can I even say about that? It's Scotty got hit on the head, and now he hates women, I guess, is what we're going with here. I know there's going to be at least one or two people that try to tell me that there's no sexism in this episode. And if you're feeling the urge to argue with me on that, I encourage you to at least watch until the end to hear what I have to say, because it does actually get a little bit worse than that, believe it or not. But anyway, Kirk and McCoy leave the bar. They hear a scream and run through the foggy streets to check it out. And they find the dancer's dead body. She's been stabbed over a dozen times. And Scotty is standing nearby with a bloody knife in his hand. It does not look good. And after the opening credits, a guy named Administrator Hengist shows up. And he's here to investigate the murder. And he's played by John Fiedler, who is probably most famous for being the voice of Piglet in the Winnie the Pooh cartoons. And he says there aren't any real murder investigators on the planet because there's really no crimes like this. He's also not from Argalius. He says the Argalians prefer to hire their administrative offices from other planets. What a coincidence. Our planet seems to do the same thing. And they asked Scotty what happened. He doesn't seem to remember. He was up ahead of her, leading the way through the fog. He heard a scream, he turned, and that's all he can recall. And to complicate things, Kirk says he has a diplomatic responsibility. If they want to arrest Scotty, or even convict him, there isn't really anything Kirk can do about it. McCoy says Scotty is suffering from a concussion, and that might have had something to do with him blacking out. They also find that only Scotty's fingerprints were on the murder weapon. And then Prefect Jarrus shows up with his wife, Sibo. I guess he's kind of like the governor of this planet. And he says that some Argalians have this empathic ability, and his wife is one of them. He wants to use her abilities to determine whether Scotty is innocent or guilty. Kirk agrees to this, but he also wants to beam down a technician with something called a psycho tricorder. I mean, what the hell is that exactly? Does it have Norman Bates in it or something? Apparently, it will give a detailed account of everything that's happened to Scotty in the last 24 hours, which is kind of insane. I mean, I can think of dozens of occasions where this device would have proved useful, but it's never used before this or after this. In any case, Jarvis allows it, the technician beams down, and of course, it's some hot blonde lady. So, we know where this is going. And inexplicably, Kirk sends Scotty into a room with the technician alone so she can perform the test. I mean, what the fuck? I love Scotty. And he's innocent, of course. But he, right now, is a murder suspect. And you're going to put him in a room alone with this person. It's crazy. And of course, they notice that the knife is missing and they hear a scream. They all rush in and they find the technician dead with multiple stab wounds. And Scotty is incoherently sitting in a chair next to her. And he once again has no memory of the event. Then they bring in two other possible suspects named Tark and Morla. They were both in the bar the night of the first murder. But Tark was the first victim's father. And he just wants justice for his daughter. Morla, who is a much more likely suspect, was a jealous ex-boyfriend. And naturally, Kirk believes that could be a motive. And Spock calls Kirk, and he says he doesn't trust the empathic techniques of the Argalians. He suggests beaming Scotty up to the Enterprise to run their own tests. But Kirk says the Argalians have jurisdiction, and he has no choice but to cooperate. So Sibu begins doing her empathic mumbo-jumbo, and it's very much like a seance. They hold hands around a table, and she says there's evil here. She says the word Regic over and over, and the lights go out. She screams, and when the lights come back on, Scotty is holding the woman, and she's been stabbed in the back, and she's dead. I mean, Jesus. When Scotty hears a scream, he should just start running away from it, not towards it. It's not helping him. It doesn't take a law expert to see that this looks pretty bad for Scotty. And three women are dead, all within like the span of what feels like 15 minutes. Scotty is on pace to outshine Jason Voorhees right now. Although this victim was only stabbed once, as opposed to a dozen times. Maybe that's a sign of improvement. Glass half full? I don't know. And Jarvis' wife was just killed, but he doesn't seem to be upset about this at all, really. He seems shocked by it, but he's not sad or angry. Maybe that's just an Argalian thing. But either way, he's not super emotional about it. And Kirk tells him that they should beam up to the Enterprise to try some of the tests that Spock suggested. And Jarvis agrees. But he says if Scotty is found guilty of these crimes, he will be sentenced to death by slow torture. Jesus. Not such a fun-loving planet after all, I guess. So, they all beam up to the Enterprise and give Scotty a futuristic polygraph test. The computer says that Scotty's injuries would not have caused any functional amnesia, which could just mean that he's lying about not remembering anything. And Scotty says that unlike the first two murders, he didn't black out when Sibu was killed. It went dark. He says he went to move towards her. He heard the scream, but something was in his way. Some kind of entity. And the computer says he's telling the truth. He says he didn't kill Sibu. Once again, the computer confirms that he's being truthful. Then they ask the jealous boyfriend some questions as well. He denies killing anyone, and he's also telling the truth. I don't know why he was still even considered a suspect at this point. I mean, he may have had motive for the first murder, but he had absolutely no reason to kill the other two. And Kirk starts to wonder about some of the things Sibu said before she was killed. They ask the computer about the word Regic, and the computer says it's an Earth nickname for a mass murderer called Jack the Ripper. Now, I never heard of that in my life. I never heard of Jack the Ripper being called Regic as a nickname. I mean, Jack the Ripper is his nickname. But I guess Star Trek just decided to invent another one for him. And of course, they say that Jack the Ripper, whoever he was, must have died hundreds of years ago. But they also recall Sibu talking about a hunger that never dies. So, the unidentified serial killer from London in the late 1800s is somehow the murderer here. In fact, based on this alone, Kirk says that everything they've uncovered points to Jack the Ripper, which is a bit of a reach, don't you think? I mean, can you imagine that holding up in court? Yes, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, Your Honor, we present new evidence. The third victim held a seance in which she said the name Rejek, which is not a nickname for Jack the Ripper, but we're going to pretend that it is. And therefore, the true killer is Jack the Ripper's ghost. And double, therefore, Lieutenant Commander Montgomery Scott is innocent of these crimes. I rest my fucking case. I mean, Scotty would never see the light of day if he said that in court. But it's a 50-minute episode, and we got to get things moving. And they also speculate that this Rejek is a non-corporeal entity that feeds on fear, which, again, is a big fucking stretch given their current information, but okay. And the computer confirms that such an entity could exist. It lists a few examples of other similar life forms that feed on emotion, and it can take different forms. So it's actually implied that the killer was the fog from the first murder, which gives me some John Carpenter vibes. And then we get probably one of the more indefensible lines of the whole series. Spock says, and I quote, "It feeds on horror and fear and preys on women because women are more easily and more deeply terrified, generating more horror than the male of the species." Jesus, do I even have to address why that's a bad line? I mean, maybe you could argue that men try to hide their fear more than women. I guess you could say that because I guess it's more embarrassing for a man to be afraid. But you still feel fear the same way. It's got nothing to do with gender. Just a terrible, archaic line that really dates this particular episode, in my opinion. And please don't take this as me attacking the original series just for simply acknowledging that that is a bad line. Believe me, it's like my second favorite show ever. It's just that I have issues with some of the episodes. No Star Trek show is perfect. And this is one of the more imperfect ones. The setup is just really dumb because the women who were killed didn't even have that much time to be afraid. They all died very quickly. And the implication is that if they were men, they wouldn't have been quite as afraid of being stabbed to death. I mean, it's laughable. And it's made even worse by the fact that Spock is the one that says it, because it's pretty much totally illogical. But anyway, moving on. Kirk asks the computer about unsolved murders that took place after the time of Jack the Ripper. And the computer lists a bunch of events, and one of them happened on Rigel IV, which is where Hengist is from. They ask him to take the lie detector, but he refuses. The computer analyzes the knife and finds that it was also from Rigel IV. So it seems like Rejek is caught red-handed, and he turns into a stunt double with a bald cap on and goes nuts. He tries to escape, but Kirk knocks him out, and he's fucking dead. I think this is one of the funniest moments of the entire show. Kirk punches him, McCoy runs over and immediately says he's dead. Why? Why is he dead? Is a punch from Kirk that powerful? Makes no sense. But I guess it's because he was always dead, and Rejek was just controlling his reanimated corpse, which is also kind of nuts, but whatever. Then the place gets haunted. I guess Rejek needs a new host, and he's chosen the Enterprise computer. The lights flicker, and it gets real spooky, and the disembodied voice of Rejek starts shouting, and it plans to scare everyone and feed off their fear before killing them. So McCoy comes up with this anti-fear tranquilizer. He calls it a tranquilizer, but it seems to just make everyone high. Which sounds like a recipe for disaster. I mean, should Sulu be at the controls when he's this fucked up? I don't know. And then Spock decides to do this.
Computer, this is a Class A compulsory directive. Compute to the last digit the value of pi.
No, 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 no!
As we know, the value of pi is a transcendental figure without resolution. The computer banks will work on this problem to the exclusion of all else until we order it to stop.
So Spock is just using pi to drive the entity crazy, which I think is kind of funny. And it also doesn't make a lot of sense, because if he has control of the computer, why can't he stop it? But I guess he can't. So Rejek leaves the computer and possesses Jarus now. It's fucking wild. And Spock gives him the Vulcan neck pinch. Then Hengist comes back to life and he threatens another female crew member. I mean, Jesus, take that knife and put it in a different room at this point. Why is it always within arm's reach of somebody? It's crazy. And because she's high, she doesn't seem to care that her life is being threatened, because female characters in this episode are just written horribly. There's no other way to say it. And they manage to subdue him, and McCoy injects him with his THC concoction, and Rejek is high as fuck now. And they just take him to the transporter room and beam him into space. They dispersed his atoms, and they say he'll die eventually. And they base that on absolutely nothing. But okay, it's kind of crazy. I mean, I know Hengist is technically already dead, or he probably is already dead, but it still feels like if they had just thrown Reagan into the Grand Canyon at the end of The Exorcist, it's just kind of out of nowhere. And McCoy says that everyone's going to be high for at least 5 or 6 hours. I guess he gave everyone a real big bump. And then Kirk invites Spock to go to a strip club on the planet, basically. So he's just going to leave the ship while everyone is drugged out of their minds. Seems kind of irresponsible. But naturally, Spock just looks at him like he's nuts. And Kirk thinks better of it and stays on the ship. And that's how the episode ends. It's fucking wacky. I don't think I ever realized just how nuts this episode is at times. It is a really wacky one. But it kind of has elements of the early slasher formula, but it's really more of a whodunit type mystery. But it also has a seance and possession and disembodied spooky voices. They were definitely going for horror in this one. I'm a little surprised they didn't get Vincent Price to play Prefect Jarus. That would have been kind of awesome. Instead, they went with the actor who played Landru in a previous episode, which is kind of funny. He went from playing a role where he ruled over people and didn't allow them to have any freedom at all to being the leader of a hedonistic society who doesn't even seem to care when his wife is killed. Two ends of the spectrum, I guess. And this episode is also kind of cool for putting Scotty at the forefront, which is a rare thing. But I don't really like it because he doesn't seem like Scotty to me most of the time. And the idea that Scotty has issues with women now because he got in some kind of accident that was caused by a woman is pretty ludicrous. I mean, how would that have even manifested itself? When Scotty got his concussion, did he wake up and say crazy misogynistic shit? Did he refuse to work with any more female crew members? I mean, does that sound like Scotty? And now that I'm thinking about it, you know, I give Geordi a lot of shit on Next Gen for how he's portrayed when it comes to women. But you know what? Scotty is actually not that different. There are a couple episodes where Scotty is like pining for a woman who seems to want nothing to do with him. It's really weird. And of course, this episode claims that he developed a total resentment towards women. It's just kind of crazy. And I think it really hurts the episode, in my opinion. And when you add the line where Spock says that women are more easily scared than men, and the fact that every woman in the episode that has more than one speaking line is brutally murdered, I think it's safe to say that there's more than a few things about this episode that haven't aged all that well. But there are a handful of things that I do think kind of work well. It's kind of spooky at times, at least for what it is. Certainly more effective than Cat's Paw, which also had the same writer as this episode. The murder mystery is engaging for the most part, at least until the end when it's revealed that it's just, you know, Jack the Ripper's ghost. And the concept of a psycho tricorder is a little beyond ridiculous to me, but I still like the use of the computer as a lie detector. It's not the first time they've done it, but it's still pretty cool to see. And it's kind of interesting that Spock never suggests the Vulcan mind meld. That probably would have revealed some information. If it was Tuvok, forget it. He would have done it right away. Nobody loves mind melds more than Tuvok. But overall, it's just kind of a silly episode that doesn't have a lot of substance to it. The horror moments are kind of fun, but it also has some very outdated elements, and personally, it's not really one that I like to revisit all that often. But as always, let me know what you think of this one. And until next time, take it easy.
Compute to the last digit the value of pi.
No! 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 No!